Now that's it for the discussion of IPR. Now next topic that we'll be discussing on will be on TPR, that is tubing performance relationship. Whenever we are talking about IPR and TPR, we have to note that the node, the point where we are evaluating, is at the bottom hole. Okay, let me represent it schematically. It's a well bore. This is the perforation, all right. As we know, this is the reservoir and this is the flowing bottom hole, right? This point, this particular point is taken as the node. Okay, whenever we discuss about IPR and TPR, just remember this is our node. Okay, now let's discuss about tubing performance relationship. Okay, tubing performance relationship or outflow performance curve, tubing performance curve, tubing intake curve, or wellbore performance curve, everything is the same. Okay, so as per the definition, outflow performance relationship means it is a mathematical tool to assess the performance of the completion string, that is from the wellbore to the wellhead, by plotting surface flow rate to flowing bottom hole pressure. Okay, or in other words, we can also say that it is the ability to lift fluid to the surface. Okay, it is the ability to lift the fluid to the surface. When we were talking about IPR, we were saying that it is the ability of the reservoir to deliver the liquid into the wellbore. That was IPR for us. But when we are talking about TPR, at that time the definition will change. For TPR, the definition will be ability to lift the fluid till the surface. Okay, so that is TPR for us. Now the outflow system takes the energy from the inflow and use that energy to get the fluid to the surface. Okay, whatever energy we are getting from the inflow part, we are using that energy and we are passing it to the surface. In this example, the wellhead pressure is held constant and the flowing bottom hole pressure is calculated as a function of rate. Okay, whenever we are talking about TPR, okay, we will keep the wellhead pressure constant, and by keeping that, we will calculate FVHP as a function of rate. I have a good example. I have a very good example which will prove this particular point. Okay, in coming slides, it will be there. Okay, now a typical TPR curve will be like this. This is the typical TPR curve. Okay, again, remember the node is bottom hole. Bottom hole is the node for us while calculating TPR. Okay, now why? You can also see that there is this particular trend. Okay, the TPR has this particular trend. This one, see, this is there's a trend. Okay, there's a hump over here. Okay, why this occurs? If we are considering from this side, means there is increase of PWF. If we are looking at this in this direction, there is an increase of PWF. All right, and this is because liquid hold up. Okay, this is an unstable region. This is an unstable region because of the heading, tubing heading at the surface. This particular thing, of course, this is an unstable region, and we don't want our well to run at this particular stage. Okay, we always want our well to run at this stage. At this stage, this is the ideal region where our well should flow. Okay, that is the stable region. Okay, this increase. Now let's look at the TPR curve in this direction. Okay, in the right side direction, let us look. This increase of PWF is due to friction, all right, and this is what we want while calculating TPR. This is exactly what we want. Okay, now let me repeat again. This side, the increase of PWF is due to liquid holdup, and this side's increase of PWF is due to the friction. Let's discuss it in more detail. Again, very crucial point. Do not operate in unstable region because it may cause surging of wells. Okay, never. We should always avoid this particular point. This region, this is the unstable region. Well should never flow at this region. What are the possible causes? Slugging at the wellhead is a possible cause. That means big liquid and gas slugs are alternatively ejected, which can overload the surface facilities. Okay, that's why, that is one of the reason key we don't want to produce in this particular unstable zone, because there can be potential slugging, and because of slugging at the surface end, at the downstream end, you can definitely experience some disturbances, and that is not desirable for us. All right. What are the possible solutions to avoid this particular unstable zone? If your TPR goes to this unstable zone, what are the possible solutions that we can implement? Increase the amount of injected gas. If we are going for gas injection, okay, if our well is in gas injection, then one thing that we can do is we can increase the amount of gas injection. Second point is deeper gas injection. Okay, when we will discuss on gas lift, at that time I will take this particular topic in detail. As of now, just remember that deeper gas injection is also one of the solution for avoiding this instability. And third point is reducing the tubing size. Okay, this is the third point. Now again the same thing, but in other words, here as you can see, just assume that this one is the IPR curve, all right, and this blue one is my TPR curve. This is my TPR curve. Okay, here there is two point of intersection. Okay, as we all know, an IPR and TPR will always have one point of intersection. Okay, that which is our operating point. At this point only our well will flow. This is my operating point. Okay, operating point means the point of intersection of your IPR and TPR when we are considering the bottom hole as the node, and when we have stable producing condition, that is my operating point. All right. Now, since there is since the TPR has this kind of a trend, sometimes what happens is that there will be two point of intersection with the IPR. Okay, this is my TPR and this is my IPR. Because of this trend, there may be sometimes two point of intersection. Okay, at that point we always have to consider this stable wala region has to be considered, not this one. This is an unstable region. We don't have to consider that one. That is a false reading. Okay, now let's see what theory has been written. IPR and TPR have a second point of intersection at a lower flow rate, which represents unstable flow condition. At this point, tubing requires more pressure than the reservoir can provide. Thus, in this case, the tubing will act as a choke in the situation, and eventually the well will die. Okay, at a higher production rate, that means at this point, okay, at this particular point, stable operating condition is obtained, in which tubing requires lesser pressure than the reservoir is supplying. Thus, the well is flowing at a stable equilibrium. All right. I think now it is clear for all of you why this particular hump in the TPR is observed. Okay. And if at all this hump is observed, we always have to consider the stable region instead of unstable region. The unstable region may cause this high amount of slugging at the wellhead, slugging in the wellbore. And because of this slugging, there will be high amount of disturbances which is experienced at the downstream side of the wellbore, which is experienced at the downstream side of the wellhead. Okay, so that's it about this particular TPR. Now, what does the tubing relationship consist of? Okay, primarily there are three major components for TPR. First is gravity / change in potential energy. Second is the change in kinetic energy, and third is the frictional loss system. Okay, now very first thing I want to say that this particular term, that is the change in kinetic energy or the acceleration, the value is very small. Okay, and hence we can ignore this particular term while discussing about tubing relationship. Okay, while discussing the total pressure drop in the tubing. Okay, now this particular point, which is the elevation and frictional loss, these are the most important terms that we should consider while performing TPR. Okay, now what is change in potential energy or elevation? This is the equation that shows us the change in potential energy. Here delta P is the frictional is the pressure drop because of change in potential energy, and these are the abbreviations that we used, where delta P is equal to pressure drop due to potential energy, rho is the density of fluid in pound, mass per feet cube. All right, gravity is given in feet per second, length of the section is given in feet, theta is the deviation, and gc is the constant, which is 32.17 pound per pound mass per pound feet second square. All right, now coming to this part, the frictional loss in the system. Frictional loss in the system is generally given by this Darcy-Weisbach equation, okay, and it is applicable only for a laminar or a turbulent flow, okay, and it is only applicable for single phase incompressible fluid, alright. And this is the equation that we consider while calculating the frictional pressure loss in the system, okay. So these are the abbreviations that we have used. Delta P Ke is the pressure drop due to friction, F is the friction factor, Rho is the density of fluid, L is the length of section, D is the diameter of tubing, and Gc is the constant. Remember the units, okay, units will be very crucial for you while solving the numericals, alright. Now, as I've discussed earlier, if there is a vertical well and there is an horizontal well, okay, this is a perforation, okay. As discussed earlier, for a vertical well, the elevation losses will be very high. Elevation losses would be very high. Almost 80% of the losses occurs because of elevation, okay, and frictional losses would be comparatively low. But on the other side, when we are talking about the horizontal well, at that time the frictional losses dominates, okay, as compared to that of a vertical well. All right so just take a special note regarding that. Here the frictional loss is very high. All right okay. Now coming to this Darcy-Weisbach equation, again for laminar and turbulent flow it is applicable. It is used for single phase incompressible fluid. This is the equation. Okay. Now to find out the F, the friction factor value, Kolbrook-White equation has been used. Okay. And this is the equation of Kolbrook-White equation. This is the equation given by Kolbrook-White, where they have given us the formula for finding out the friction factor. Okay, that's one way. Second way is using the Moody chart. We can calculate the friction factor. There's no problem regarding that. Okay, you can use Moody chart also. Now, finding out friction factor from Moody chart, we need the Reynolds number. As we all know, Reynolds number is rho mu d upon mu. And if the Reynolds number is less than 2000, it is a laminar flow. If it lies between 2000 to 4000, it is a transition flow, and if Reynolds number is more than 4000, it is a turbulent flow. All right okay, and these are the abbreviations for the Reynolds number, where rho is the density, u is the flow speed, this is the velocity, d is the diameter of the tube, mu is the dynamic viscosity, okay, and mu is the dynamic viscosity, and this V is the kinetic viscosity. All right now coming to the tubing flow, as we all know, there won't be a single phase flow in the tubing. All right there will always be a multi-phase flow. That means there will be liquid and gas flowing through the tubing, okay, both horizontal as well as vertical flow. We can divide the flow regimes into several parts. Let's see how we can divide those regions. Okay, first talking about a vertical well. Vertical well can have a bubble flow, slug flow, churn flow, or annular flow. And for a horizontal well, we can have a stratified, intermittent, annular, or dispersed bubble flow. Okay, where stratified can be divided into smooth or wavy, intermittent can be divided into slug or elongated bubble, and etc. Alright. Now coming to this multi-phase flow in vertical tubing, okay, it is a very crucial point. Okay, I think you all should take special note regarding this particular page. Very important slide. Okay, now as we all can see, I have discussed this particular graph before. Okay, in that we have discussed till this point, that is till wellbore critical point, the journey of the fluid we have already discussed earlier. Now from the wellbore, when the fluid travels till the wellhead, okay, till the wellhead point, see, till this point, here A, A is in the reservoir, this A is in the reservoir, B is in the wellbore part, okay, very critical point. B is in the B is in the wellbore part, okay. C, point C is over here where it has reached the bubble point. Point D, this is the point D where now it is traveling in the tubing, the fluid is flowing through the tubing. Point E, see, this is the point E where it is where it has almost reached the wellhead, okay. Point F, this is the point F where separator region is there, okay. Now you can see in this particular region, we will focus on this particular tubing region, all right. Now, as we can see that now as the fluid will cross through these quality lines, okay, these are the quality lines, that means this line, for example, let me take this 80% line, okay, this means 80% of this quality line means there is 80% liquid and 20% gas, all right. Let's take example of this particular line, 60%. That means there is 60% of liquid and 40% of gas. All right. Now you can see as the fluid flows from the tubing, first it has encountered the bubble flow because in bubble flow there is comparatively less amount of gas and more amount of liquid. Okay. Now as the flow goes up and up, it will now change to slug flow. Then it changes to churn flow. Then it changes to annular flow. And finally, near the wellhead, it will change to mist flow. Alright, you got the point? Okay. Now let's see what the theory says. The high velocities experienced near the surface can result in the increasing frictional pressure gradient exceeding the decrease in hydrostatic head pressure gradient. Okay. So that the pressure in the tubing may increase as the depth decreases. Okay. This is exactly the same point what I have discussed now, but in a different language. Now coming to the theory part of bubble type of flow in a vertical tubing, as you can see, bubble flow occurs at relatively low liquid rates. Slug flow is symmetric about the pipe axis. Gas phase acts like a large bullet shaped gas pocket with diameter almost equal to that of pipe diameter. Gas pocket is generally termed as Taylor bubble. Gas slugs can act as an efficient mechanism to lift the liquid to the surface, all right. Now coming to churn flow, it is almost similar to slug flow, though it is chaotic in nature with no clear boundaries between two phases. Flow pattern is characterized by oscillatory motion. It generally occurs at high flow rates. Liquid slug becomes frothy in nature. It is also termed as frothy flow. Okay, churn flow is also termed as frothy flow. Coming to annular flow. In annular flow, liquid film thickness is almost uniform around the pipe. Okay, in annular flow, the liquid forms a film in the annular side of the tubing. Okay, inside the tubing, it forms a film around the tubing. Okay, it is characterized by a fast moving gas cone. Liquid film is highly wavy due to high interfacial stress. Okay, these are very important points. Okay, the point that I mentioned over here can be asked in multiple choice questions. Okay, and now since the gate pattern has also changed, where multiple answers can be there for a particular question, then this kind of theory will be useful to you guys. All right. Coming to the mist flow particular part. Okay, this part this is the sand face part of the wellbore and this is the wellhead of the well. Okay, now I have discussed, it has been shown, it has a bubble region, it has a slug region, churn region and annular region. Okay, now this is the, in this side, this graph shows depth versus liquid holdup and gas velocity. All right, very important curve. Okay, now you can see that this is a very interesting region that you all should observe. Okay, this is a very important and a very interesting region that you should all observe. Okay, this particular region, you can experience it while intermittent gas lift. If there is intermittent gas lift in a field, then this kind of reversal of the trend can be observed. Okay, I will discuss this thing in detail. Okay, when I discuss intermittent gas lift. Okay, as of now, just remember that for an intermittent gas lift, the slug flow is most efficient. Okay, whenever you have an intermittent IGL or intermittent gas lift, you desire to have a slug flow. All right. And on the other hand, whenever you have a continuous gas lift, then bubble flow is the most desirable one whenever you have a continuous gas lift. All right. And why this particular thing occurs? See, why this thing occurs over here? You can see in this point there is a huge slug. Okay, there is a huge continuous slug of a gas. Okay, huge continuous slug of a gas. As a result, there is hardly any liquid which is present in the annulus. See, there is hardly any liquid in the annulus. Okay, that's why the liquid holdup over here is reducing. Okay, that's why there is less liquid holdup is less. But since the gas pocket is very large, at this point the gas velocity is high. Okay, I think you guys got it. Okay. Now coming to the multiphase flow in a horizontal tubing. Okay, as you all know, you have a stratified, intermittent, and distributed flow over here. Okay, this graph is very important, where it is gas superficial velocity, that is gas velocity versus the liquid velocity for a horizontal tubing. Very important graph. Okay, I think you have to remember these points, like where will let's say if there is such graph given in examination, and sometimes question may be asked like match the following question, like they would have given A, B, C, D. Okay, and they will give us the options, like one will there will be these many options. Okay, now you have to match the options. Such kind of questions can be asked, maybe asked in GATE examination. Okay, so you have to remember this particular graph. It's a very important. Again, the concept remains the same as we have discussed in the vertical tubing. This is the theory part. I think you guys can go through this part. Okay, when we are discussing about effect of variables, okay, on TPR, these are the variables that affect the TPR: tubing size, flow rate, GLR, density, viscosity, water cut, slippage, kinetic energy. Okay, these are all the variables that affect our TPR. Okay, the trend in the TPR is affected by these many things. Okay, now for example, we will discuss all of this in detail. Okay, before discussing the variables that are affecting our TPR, let's see how we construct TPR. Okay, how we construct TPR using pressure traverse curve using Gilbert. Okay, this particular question, I think it has been asked in GATE 2019, if I'm not wrong. There was a graph given and we were told to find out some flowing bottom wall pressure from the parameters given. And I think Gilbert curve was also given. It was a 2-mark numerical question. Okay, so let's see how we construct TPR using pressure traverse curve. This is a classic TPR curve. This is the classic pressure gradient curve, a pressure traverse curve rather, which was given by Gilbert. Okay, Gilbert. Okay, now for this, you can see there are in books like in Beck's and Brill. Okay, almost last few pages, last pages will be having such kind of curves. Okay, these are all pressure traverse curves. Okay, for example, let's take example of this curve. This curve is for a tubing size of 2.5 inch. This curve is applicable for the size of, for the tubing size of 2.5 inch, where the producing rate is 1500, where the water specific gravity is 1.074, gas specific gravity is 0.65, and average flowing temperature is 140 degree Fahrenheit. Okay, this particular curve is applicable for the well having these conditions. Okay, then only you can use this curve for calculating flowing bottom wall pressure. Okay, now let's assume that you are let's take an example over here. Okay, now what we have to do over here is we have to calculate the flowing bottom wall pressure when the tubing head pressure is zero. Okay, the question over here is, here the tubing head pressure has been given zero. It has also been given that the GLR is 400 standard cubic feet per barrel and the depth of the well is 6000 feet. All right, these are the, now let's see how to calculate flowing bottom wall pressure. And by the way, these curves, these lines are for different GLRs. Okay, these lines are for different GLRs. Like this is for 0 GLR, 25 SCF per barrel, 50 SCF per barrel, 100 SCF per barrel, 200 SCF per barrel. Okay, now let's see how to calculate FBHP. Since our THP is 0 and depth of the well is 6000 feet, which is given in the question, we can directly plot a line vertical line from 0 to 6000 feet. From 6000 feet, we have to go, or we have to move horizontally till we reach 400 SCF per barrel as given in the question. Where is 400? Okay, this is my 400 SCF per barrel. Once we have reached the 400 SCF per barrel, now we have to again go vertically up to get the result, which is 1260. Okay, this is my FBHP that I obtained. Okay, I think this is a very simple question. Here my tubing head pressure is zero, so that's why we were able to calculate flowing bottom wall pressure very conveniently. Okay, now let's discuss a comparatively a difficult one. Next case. Okay, for the same well, everything is same, but now the tubing head pressure has been given as 200. Okay, again we have to find for GLR 400 cubic feet per barrel, and depth is again same, everything is same. Okay, but over here this only difference is the tubing head pressure has been given as 200. In the previous example, there was only the tubing head pressure was given as 0. Okay, now let's see how to calculate flowing bottom wall pressure in this particular case. Now, since THP has been given, we have to address that in our calculation. See, this is my THP point at 200 psi, right? For 200 psi, this is my THP point at 200 psi. So I plot a line, I plot a vertical line from 200 till the GLR of 400 point, the curve of GLR with 400 SCF per barrel. Okay, from that I go horizontally till to the depth point. Okay, now this depth is termed as zero depth. This is my zero depth. Okay, this is my zero depth. Now from this point, that is from this particular depth, we have to put 6000 feet. See, from this particular point I will add 6000. Alright, I will go again horizontally to the 400 GLR curve, GLR line, and from there same process I will go up, and now I got the flowing bottom wall pressure as 1550. This is my flowing bottom wall pressure. Alright, I think you guys got it. Here the catch is zero depth. The funda of zero depth is very important to understand in this particular case. Whenever there is THP given and you are told to calculate flowing bottom wall pressure, then we have to first use the zero depth concept. From zero depth, once you got the zero depth, you add the depth of the well given to us, and from that depth you go horizontally to the GLR curve line, and from that point you go up to the pressure line, alright, to obtain flowing bottom wall pressure. I think it is very much clear for you guys. After finding flowing bottom wall pressure by using Gilbert curve, let's see how we actually construct the TPR curve. Okay, whenever you are using some softwares of system analysis like Prosper, okay, then Prosper uses this particular algorithm to calculate TPR for you. Okay, they run the iterations, the software itself will run the iterations to get us the TPR curve. All right, now let's see how we can manually construct a TPR curve. All right, now in this example the wellhead pressure is held constant and the flowing bottom wall pressure is calculated as a function of rate. Okay, this is a very important point. Okay, whatever I will be discussing in this particular presentation, in this particular page, I have kept my wellhead pressure constant throughout, and I have calculated the flowing bottom wall pressure as a function of rate. All right, okay. We'll be constructing our TPR curve. Right, now let's see. As mentioned in the definition, as mentioned over here, okay, we have kept the PWH constant. Okay, and I am taking, let's say this particular curve is for Q1. It is a curve for Q1. Okay, and now what we are doing is, for this particular curve with Q1 flow rate, I have taken and some constant GLR also. Okay, I have assumed the GLR will be constant. Okay, I have plotted this particular curve. Okay, I have explained you how to plot this particular to obtain flowing bottom wall pressure. Okay, so from this Q1 I got a PWF1. All right, see over here, for this q1 I got pwf1. Okay, now we have to plot the second point for q2. Okay, now I will take a graph with q2 flow rate and with same glr, okay, and with same tubing size, everything same, even with same depth, okay, even with same depth. Now we will repeat the same process, okay, and while repeating the same process we will get a q2 and a corresponding pwf2. See, second point. Similarly, repeat the process for p3 and p4. Okay, now you are getting 4 points. Once you have these 4 points, now you can connect. Now you can connect these 4 points to get a TPR curve. Alright, this is how actually in the models, actually in the softwares, TPR is been calculated. Alright. Okay. Now let's see how different variables affect our TPR trend. Let's take example of this effect of water cut. Alright. Now we can, as we can see, water cut, as the water cut increases, see, as the water cut increases, my TPR is going upwards. Alright. The reason, as we all know, the density is increasing, density of the fluid, as the water cut increases, the density of the column increases in the density of column increases in the wellbore. Okay, because of that, my elevation losses and my friction losses will increase. As we all know, the elevation losses, let's say P is equal to rho gh, okay, the elevation losses, density is affected, density will affect our elevation losses. Also, the density will affect the frictional losses as well. Okay, now since we are increasing the water cut, the total pressure loss will increase. Okay, as a result, with increasing water cut, my TPR curve has a tendency to go upwards. Okay, that means, in other words, let me say, as my TPR go upwards, my flow rate obtained will be less. The liquid flow rate will be obtained will be less. Okay. Now coming to effect of separator pressure. Again, now as we are giving more amount of back pressure to the well, okay, that also results in reduction of flow rate. See, this is a 50 psi back pressure given by separator 200 500. As I am increasing the back pressure, my flow rate is getting reduced. Okay, TPR is moving upwards, which is not visible. We need an optimum point. Okay. Now coming to effect of tubing size. In this thing, this is a very interesting curve. As I am increasing the diameter, of the tubing, my TPR is going down. Okay. But after some point, there will be a reverse of the trend. Okay. This reverse of the trend is because of effect of liquid loading. Okay, now you can see this is the effect of this. This is a beautiful graph which shows, which is plotted between production rate and tubing diameter. Okay, here you can see that as I'm increasing the diameter, my production rate is increasing. Okay, production rate is increasing, but after this point, after this particular point. My production rate is dropping. Okay, this is because of effect of loading. All right, this is a very important concept. Now let's come to effect of GLR and gas injection rate. All right, notion that as we increase the gas injection, then we will get more amount of liquid on the surface. Okay, in a gas lift well, if I keep on injecting more quantity of gas, then we will get more production. Okay, actually that's not true. Okay, see, this is a graph between production rate and gas injection rate. All right, now you can see, now as I'm injecting the gas, the production is increasing, but at this point it has started decreasing. Right, this point it has started decreasing again. Okay, now let's see in our TPR how does this particular thing reflects. This is a TPR curve, production rate versus flow rate. Okay, now you can see I am injecting the gas GLR. I am injecting gas in this particular well. initially it was a zero GLR, that is no gas injection. Now with time, now I am increasing to 50, TPR increased, 100. See the intersection point. Q increased, for 150 it has increased again, for 200 again it has increased, but for 250 it has again increased. But after 250, see, after 250 GLR, for 300 it has begin decreasing again. For 300 it has begin decreasing, for 300 flow rate is less, and for 400 even lesser. Okay, that means there is a transition, that means it has reached this point. Okay, now this point is generally termed as over injection of gas. And if I am injecting in this particular region, this is under injection. Okay, for optimum gas injection we need to be at this particular point. This is my optimum gas injection range. Okay, we don't have to go to this under injection zone or over injection zone. We have to stay in this particular zone to get the maximum amount of liquid rate from the well while injecting gas. All right. And why this particular, what is the funda behind this over injection, is that once you are injecting the gas above the optimum point, the friction pressure or the frictional losses starts increasing, because once you are over injecting gas, the velocity of the gas will increase drastically, and because of the increase in velocity of gas while injecting, my friction losses have also increased drastically. Okay, as a result my TPR has shifted upwards. Okay, as a result I am getting lesser flow rate in my lesser flow in the well. Okay, as we all know, our main purpose of gas injection is to reduce the flowing bottom hole pressure. Okay, this condition is only applicable till we inject the gas at the optimum rate possible. But once we exceed the optimum rate and we are going for over injection, then instead of reducing the flowing bottom hole pressure, we are increasing it, which is not desirable. Okay, we are increasing the unintentionally, we are increasing the flowing bottom hole because of over injection. Because due to over injection, the velocity of gas has risen drastically, and because of this higher gas velocity, my friction losses has also risen. Okay, so this is the concept behind effect of GLR on the injection, effect of GLR slash gas injection rate on the TPR curves. Now let's discuss wellhead performance curve and choke performance curve. Okay, as we have discussed IPR and TPR, there the node was bottom hole. Okay, now while discussing wellhead performance curve and the choke performance curve, we have to take special note that over here, whenever I am discussing this point, my wellhead is used as a node, and that too at a constant separator pressure. Alright, just take a note. For wellhead performance curve and choke performance curve, we are considering the node, we are considering the wellhead as the node, okay, not the wellbore. In IPR and TPR, my node was at bottom hole, but for wellhead performance curve and choke performance curve, we are using wellhead as our node, and we are considering my separator pressure is constant throughout while we are plotting relationship of WPR, that is wellhead performance, and CPC, that is choke performance. All right. Now let's see how this thing works. Again, I have plotted. This is the wellhead performance curve. It is almost similar to my IPR. Okay. And this is the choke performance curve. This is this choke performance curve are for different choke sizes: 16x64, 25x64, 32x64, and 40x64. Okay. Now, based on our optimum point, we can select which size of choke can be used. Okay, based on the optimum point. So let's discuss about the wellhead and the Christmas tree. First of all, the Christmas tree means whatever portion is present. This particular portion is the Christmas tree, okay, above the this tubing hanger. Okay, and here the major components of a Christmas tree are master valves. There will be two master valves, upper master valve and lower master valve. Okay, then there would be a wing valve. Okay, there will be a swab valve, a flow line valve, and here it is, the choke, a very important part. We will be discussing about wellhead and Christmas tree in pretty much detail when we take up surface production classes. Okay, for as of now, you just have to go through this schematic. Okay, and this diagram over here, again, it's a very beautiful diagram. A nice cross section of the wellhead has been shown over here. Okay, we will be discussing it in our surface production class. So let's move ahead. Coming to wellhead chokes, the functions of wellhead choke is given here. Okay, first is, it limits the production rate for controlled pressure depletion. It protects the surface equipment from slugging. It avoids sand problems due to high drawdown. Okay, that means over here, this choke will help us to control the amount of drawdown. And let's say if our well is in a sandstone reservoir, then sand problems can be mitigated to a good amount of, to a good extent rather. Helps to control the flow rate to avoid water or gas cooling. We will be learning in reservoir engineering that there is a critical rate, okay, that we are obtaining from Meyer-Garder equation. Okay, and if you are producing that particular well above the critical rate, then there are chances that the water or gas cooling can occur in the well. Water cooling is still can be controlled by various water control jobs, water shutoff jobs. But if the gas starts to come into the reservoir, then it will be a very difficult job to control the amount of gas. Okay, so it will be always beneficial that we don't have that much of gas cooling in our well. And if at all it starts cooling, if the gas gets cooling, then it becomes very difficult to mitigate that particular gas. For water, again, we have water shutoff jobs. Okay, and there are other various completion methods that are available in the industry, like there are inflow control devices present. Okay, these inflow control devices are generally used in horizontal wells. Okay, in horizontal wells, in an horizontal well, okay, throughout this section, okay, in an horizontal well, throughout this particular section, the pressure drop varies. Okay, particularly at this point, the heel point, the pressure drop will be very high. Pressure drop will be very high as compared to that of a toe point. Okay, now to have a uniform pressure drop across the horizontal section, ICD, inflow control devices, are generally used. Okay, to maintain the uniform pressure drop across the horizontal section. Okay. Okay, now coming to the type of wellhead chokes, there are two type of chokes, positive and adjustable. Positive chokes are also known as fixed chokes, and second is the adjustable choke. I have never seen an adjustable choke. I have always seen this type of choke, that is fixed choke, positive chokes. Okay, and in adjustable choke, you will have some handrail. Okay, you will have some handrail where you can adjust the choke. Okay, by rotating the wheel. Talk about chokes, then this particular term, that is this ratio PU by PD is very important. Okay, again, PU by PD is this, gamma plus 1 divided by 2 raised to gamma plus 1 upon gamma. Okay, now this concept is very important. Whenever we have choke, we will always try to get a critical flow. Okay, critical flow is very essential. Critical flow, okay, because this critical flow prevents a pressure disturbance downstream of the choke from being propagated upstream. Okay, since a pressure wave cannot travel faster than the speed of sound. Okay, in the critical flow regime, the fluid flow will have the velocity almost similar to that of sonic velocity. Okay, the pressure wave will travel at the speed of sound. Alright, the well's performance upstream of the choke can thus be decoupled from the events occurring in the downstream flow line and the separation system. This has had obvious advantages when trying to control the well's performance. Okay, let me explain it another way. Like, let's say if there is any sort of disturbance in the downstream part. Let's say there is any sort of disturbance in the downstream part. Let's say a separator this fluctuation in pressure, separator pressure. Okay, then because of this fluctuation, there are chances that it may affect the production also. Okay, now in order to mitigate that particular phenomena, we use choke. Okay, appropriate chokes are used so that any downstream disturbances occurring in the production system should not affect the upstream part of the choke. Okay, for that we need to have a flow which lies in the range of critical flow, this particular range. Okay, that's why this PU by PD ratio is a very, very crucial thing when we discuss about choke. Single phase. Now let's talk about single phase liquid flow through the choke. Okay, this is the formula for calculating that particular thing. Okay, this is the conversion. I have done the unit conversion over here. Okay, that is Q is equal to 22,800 C into D square P2 minus P1 upon rho in square root, where D is in diameter, D is the diameter in inches, pressure is in psi, and the density is in pound per feet cube. Okay, now single phase gas flow through the choke. Earlier one was a liquid flow. For the gas flow through the choke, this particular equation will be followed. Alright. Again, you have to remember this formula. There is no other option. You have to remember this formula. Okay. Again, the derivation part, to be very frank, it is out of the scope. Okay. We need to apply it directly whenever a question has been asked. Okay, one critical point over here is this gamma, the value of gamma. Gamma is a function of specific heat ratio, that is Cp by Cv up is equal to K. Diameter, it is a function of diameter ratio of throat, orifice throat to the inlet pipe, and the ratio of downstream to upstream pressure. Okay, now this again is a very important formula. There's multiphase flow through the choke. Okay, it is given by Gilbert. This guy gave the formula, Gilbert, and this is the formula. Okay, in this formula you can calculate the wellhead pressure. You can calculate the wellhead pressure with the help of gas GLR and with the help of the choke size. Okay, with the help of GLR, with the help of liquid flow rate, and with the help of choke size. Okay, this is a very important formula. Okay, and by the way, these things, this A1, A2, these are the constants. A1, A2, A3 constants, and these constants will be given. You don't have to remember this thing. These constants you don't have to remember. It will be given in the gate examination if at all this type of question is been asked. Again, a very important point is the choke size. The unit of choke size will always be denoted in 1/64 of the inch. Okay, it may be, let's say, 12/64 inch. It may be 16/64. Okay, always 1/64 inch. This is the unit of a choke. All right. Now let's look. Now whatever we have discussed. Okay. Now let's summarize it. All right. Now this is the IPR obtained, and this is the TPR obtained, and this is the operating point that I obtained from IPR TPR. Again, remember the node here. To get the IPR and TPR, my node was at bottom hole. Okay. My node was at bottom hole. Okay, I plotted IPR, I plotted TPR, I got the operating point. Alright. Now from the operating point, I am getting this line. Okay. Now I have changed the node. Now I have taken wellhead as my node. Okay. I took wellhead as a node and I constructed this wellhead performance curve. Alright, this wellhead performance curve and this red one, the optimum point, I got this particular intersection. Alright, now what I did, to get the optimum choke, whatever choke performance curve gives, whatever choke satisfies this particular condition, I will select that particular choke. Alright, got it? And you can also see from this diagram that this much amount of delta P has been used up for the reservoir to wellbore. When the fluid flows from reservoir to wellbore, this much has been gone, this much pressure drop has been occurred from the perforation to wellhead, this much when the fluid flows from the wellhead to the separator, this much pressure loss has been obtained, and Finally, this is the delta P. This is the pressure drop that is obtained generally in the separator to facilities condition. Okay, separator. I won't be taking artificial lift in detail in this lecture. Okay, we will be having a dedicated video to artificial lift. Okay, just as of now, let's see where the need of artificial lift comes into play. Okay, now for this particular question, you can for this particular image, you can see there is no intersection point at all. Okay, that means we need this TPR curve to be at this point, okay, so that we can get an operating point. This energy, the energy required to take this IPR from here to here, okay, for that some sort of extra energy from the outside we require, okay, and that's where this artificial lift comes into play. All right, so that's all for today. Hope all of you have enjoyed this session. Please like, share, comment on our YouTube channel, subscribe, please remember to subscribe to our YouTube channel, and follow us on Instagram and Facebook. And if you have any sort of queries, you can mail us at petrogyan@gmail.com. okay, and you can definitely DM us in our social media handles if you have any sort of questions or queries. Okay, so Jai Hind. Thank you.